So the Ranpak wobble is legendary, and as with a lot of legends, they're not always entirely true. The Ranpak is now on though. So it takes a little bit longer now to power up. There you go, there's the cursor. So we could type in our program again, 10, print, let's do hello this time. Took a little bit longer to enter it into the memory. Go to 10, so there's our program. But as you can see, the machine itself kind of wobbles a little bit as you're typing in code. And if that Ranpak wobbles too much, we lose the data. But actually our one, and we haven't done anything, you know, clever here. This is just a standard old Ranpak. But actually, if we wobble it, move the machine around a little bit, actually, if we now type run, it's still working okay. So, you know, the Ranpak wobble.
Because I remember there were all sorts of ways that you could hack this. What was the make it safe?
The classic one that everybody talks about is the BlueTech, allegedly recommended by Sir Clive himself. And you would put a piece of BlueTech between the case and the Ranpak, and that would just stop them moving. I think in reality, that doesn't necessarily work that well. How strong is BlueTech, you know? But we've had some brilliant resolutions to this. So quite often, we've probably had two or three machines, ZX81s, and they're donated on a piece of white melamine chipboard. And there's a blooming great big ugly metal aluminium bracket that holds that to the piece of wood. And then there's another aluminium bracket that holds the Ranpak down as well. They look really ugly. But actually, when we laughed about this, we plugged it in and we tried it. Actually, if you still messed around with it too much, it would still lose that memory. This one's particularly good connections for whatever reason, I don't know, that it's just good.
Maybe it's like a good Y.
Age actually made it worse, because as the machine, the connections tarnished a little bit, that got in the way and the connections, and that, you know, caused more problems. But the one that I did, which was a bit harsh, I admit, is to take my machine out of the case completely and chop the wires that hold this connector in place and then solder it directly to the back of the machine itself. That was harsh, but it worked. And I ended up, and I really regret this, taking a machine that I had at the time called a Tangerine Microtan 65. It's actually quite a sought after machine now. There weren't many of them, but disgracefully, I took the keyboard off it because I had no particular use for that machine. And I took all the tracks off the back of the keyboard and rewired the matrix so it matched the ZX81. And I had a proper ZX81 with a proper keyboard and a soldered on Ranpak. So it was absolutely, completely reliable.
So what sort of programs would you write on your ZX81?
All sorts of random stuff. I mean, I had a go at writing games. I had grand visions of writing these amazing games. And I wrote these kind of, I mentioned a game called Keys of Kral that I'd seen on the NASCOM some years before. And I wrote a version of that, which I called Crystal Castle or Caves, I don't know. And I never did finish it. It was probably rubbish anyway. But I did adding up things, you know, kind of bank accounts. I was 11 or so. So the thing is, the most important thing about this machine is the thoughts of what you could do with it. Not necessarily for a lot of us what we actually did with it. But that's just as valid, because then later on, you know, you'd have that drive then to go and do it on machines that, you know, would have more use to you later on. A lot of the time I was loading in things like Lunar Landing and some of the games. I was bought the maths pack for mine. This is the junior education pack, but Dad, you know, wanted me to learn, so obviously he bought me the maths pack and I'd become a mathematician at some point, which still has not happened. So instead I managed to get them to buy me the games tape. I think these were about $3.99. I remember having, I think, two of these. And these hold a lot of affection for me because of just the look of them. I had two of these. One was games, one was the maths pack. And I had another game, which I think might have been an Anirog game, maybe a Kong type copy or something. I can't remember now. I've had three original tapes for it.
And the look and the feel is all very similar. You know, there's a real branding thing there going on.
Well, Sinclair, I think, was really, really cute on this side of things. He was very, very much about the aesthetics. And the look and the presentation of those products. And again, although they take stick, you've got to look at them and look at the, you know, the design, the aesthetic of these, and realise actually there was a lot of thought going into it. Having a machine that was this small in comparison with something like the MZ80K that was there, you know, there is a big difference.
So
and there is a beauty to this.
These are contemporaries then, are they?
This came before, but this was in the sort of machine that people would have recognised as a computer. I think for Clive to come along and have a product that looked like this, it was space age at the time. Look at the manual. The manual itself has got that kind of space age representation on it. And I think there a lot is to be said for the design and the aesthetics of these machines. As much as they were built at that price point, they were done in a way, with a very, pretty professionally plastic moulded case. So I think a lot has to be credited to Sinclair on that score. And he had a history of it as well, miniaturisation, to a fault in some cases, he was making miniature TVs and little radios and this kind of stuff and the calculators that he was making. Sometimes he was trying to get too much into too small a space, and that caused heat problems and whatever. But, to have successes, you've got to have failures. And in my mind, this is a huge, huge success. And I think to a lot of people's minds, a really, really important machine.
He was then trying to get in with the BBC, wasn't he?
The BBC put out to tender a project to create a machine that they could use for their television programme. So the government were very much pushing the idea of home computers and trying to get everybody involved with them, understand them, what they were, because there was a bit of resistance in, computers. They're going to lose us all our jobs at this time. Computers were the thing that were, kind of feared in some respects. So the government were pushing that kind of thing, and the BBC were going to make a programme about it. They put out to tender for this project. They brought a specification. The BBC computer itself was pretty much specced up by the BBC. They'd take a lot of credit for the way that machine turned out. And anybody could come along and produce that machine or put forward plans to do it. Sinclair did. And Acorn did, apparently Newbury Computers, Newbury Newbrain, had put forward something. Ultimately, long story short, Acorn got that tender. You could argue that they didn't necessarily have the machine they were selling to the BBC at that time, but they had plans and they knew what they were going to do to make it. And Sinclair just didn't get it. Now, the whys and wherefores of that, I don't know. Bottom line is he lost that, and he was really angry about it. The film Microman kind of puts that into perspective. But it was just one of those things. His sort of specifications for the machine that he thought should be used didn't really match with what the BBC wanted. You could argue that there were reasons why Sinclair probably should have been. The cost is a big deal. The BBC Micro was £399. And for a lot of people, they use their BBC Micros at school. They typed in lines of code, really, really simple, basic programs. It was only kind of the higher end students that were getting in there and doing the clever stuff. So you could argue that actually the Sinclair probably did have, and I know actually was in schools anyway, a place within schools and within teaching because of the price point. A lot more students would have had access to it. I know schools had them anyway. They went out and bought Sinclairs because of that price. And you could buy programs on those tapes and load them in from tapes. So that was feasible. You tended to spend ages just getting the volume exactly right.